I am a voice crying out in the wilderness.
Good news for him and for you and for everybody, because we are going to have peace in Jerusalem.
The Key of David with Gerald Flurry.
Greetings, everyone. Europe is about to burst on the world scene as a superpower, a great superpower, and it will be called the Holy Roman Empire. There have been six Holy Roman Empires over the past 1,500 years, and the Vatican has been telling the people of Europe for many years to find their roots or recapture their glorious past. And of course, they are referring to the Holy Roman Empire. The Holy Roman Empire throughout history has been comprised mainly of Germany and the Vatican, and it has been a fearsome power throughout those years all over Europe and much of the world. The most popular leader, political leader of that empire has been Charlemagne, and he was the second ruler of the Holy Roman Empire. And they talk a lot about Charlemagne today. Some of the leaders of Europe say that the way Europe is organized now, it can never really be effective, that they need it to sort of coalesce around a new Charlemagne. And they discuss that quite a lot. They look up to this man called Charlemagne. And believe it or not, there is going to become a new Charlemagne on the world scene. That is prophesied in your Bible. And it also says that God is going to use that power to fulfill His will. And that doesn't mean good news for Britain and America. It doesn't mean good news necessarily for the entire world, but it's going to be concluded with the best news you could possibly ever hear. But at this time, it is certainly an ominous sign, but a sign with the most exciting conclusion that we could imagine, because it's going to be concluded by the return of Jesus Christ Himself. Now, that sounds far-fetched to a lot of people. But we need to think, if we're going to understand what the Holy Roman Empire is about and that new Charlemagne is about, we'd better understand something about the Holy Roman Empire and Charlemagne, who had to wade through rivers of blood to conquer Europe and win converts to Catholicism. That's just a fact of history that I think nobody would really argue with. But Europe is moving very fast toward this new Charlemagne, and it's not really getting headlines in the media of the world, not at least like it should. And the West needs to be alert to that, because it is in many ways a warning to the West about what is coming in the future. But just imagine that it's going to take a man to really unify Europe the way it is going to have to be unified to do what they want to do. And that is going to happen. So you need to understand, though, that it's going to change this world dramatically, and it's going to change your life in ways that you can't even imagine. It is going to do that in a bad way and in a good way. Certainly, there's some bad news included in that. So I want to talk to you today about waiting for that new Charlemagne. If you see world news and you're watching world news, you know it is about to come. German Chancellor Angela Merkel recently made a speech that I believe was the most significant speech made by any German leader since World War II and about what the Germans did in World War II. And I think she made a statement that many people have been waiting for over 60 years. And you have to say, in a way, I think it stamped her as a great leader, because she made a statement that really disagreed with the majority of her own people. So it wasn't exactly a political move, and it wasn't even close to that, I don't think. But she was speaking before the Jewish Knesset, and that is our Congress or the British Parliament. And here is what she said. This ought to have made world headlines. It didn't, but it should have. And I'll explain to you why as we go along. But here is what she said to the Knesset audience. The mass murder of 6 million Jews carried out in the name of Germany has brought indescribable suffering to the Jewish people, Europe, and the entire world. And she said the Germans were actually filled with shame because of the Nazi Holocaust. And then she visited the Holocaust Museum in Israel. And I just recently visited it myself. And it's quite a stirring and emotionally draining experience, let me tell you. But notice what somebody wrote in the Jerusalem Post right after she spoke. Manfred Gerstenfeld wrote a column titled, "When Angela Merkel, or What Angela Merkel Couldn't Say Out Loud." What she couldn't say out loud, here's what he said. Few in Israel realize that a majority of Germans probably disagree with several key statements she made here about her country's past, including the mention of shame and guilt. Now, that is a true statement, and I think it's easy to be proved. But she was actually telling the Israelis that the German people are repentant about what they did in World War II, but does that really square with what the people in Germany really do believe? Is that what they talk about and express? Now, again, this comment and this bold and brave lady should have been encouraged in that direction by the world and its media, but that didn't really happen, certainly not as I have seen. And from what I've seen so far. But she certainly was a courageous leader. And if you remember, there was a time when Anwar Sadat, the leader of Egypt, made a similar speech in the Knesset and tried to swing his nation around to getting along and having peace with the Jews, and they assassinated him. So I think we'd have to say that Angela Merkel certainly could be hurt politically, and maybe putting her life at risk by making such a statement, such a courageous statement in this evil world. And oh, how rare such a statement is. When is the last time you heard a statement like that from a political leader? I'll bet you can't even remember one. And yet, that has certainly the ring of character to it, and it's too bad that we don't recognize real leadership more when we see it. And I mean real leadership. Trying to take your nation the way you know it should go, regardless of the political consequences. That is has the ring of greatness to it. All we have to do is study our history books to see that. But I wonder, you see, again, if the Vatican had backed her in this, what an impact something like that could have had. But is that the case? Are they thinking the same way? Well, I think we need to look at it closely, because her statement was, well, something you would expect to come from a religious leader in a way. And the Pope has been very critical of other religions lately, and I think that's pretty obvious. And I'd just like to briefly mention that, because it has stirred up quite a lot of controversy in the world, what he is doing. If you remember, and he quoted not too long ago, a Byzantine emperor who said that Muhammad had really, what anything new that he had contributed was evil and humane. He quoted that, and of course there was quite an outcry in the world of Islam.